This lecture is about LOL diagrams, which are a very specific way that physicists represent how energy is changing in a system. LOL diagrams all look like this, which is why they're called LOL diagrams. You can see it looks kind of like LOL. Basically, there are two graphs of energy with a circle in the middle to describe the objects in a system. Specifically, the graph on the left means the amount of energy before an event happens. The graph on the right means the amounts of energy after an event. And the circle in the middle is where you draw objects in the system we're looking at. So when we're considering a system, we have to consider which objects are a part of our energy system. I'll take you through a bunch of examples and show you how to construct an LOL diagram for each one. For the first few examples, just keep in mind that in a closed energy system, the total energy has to be the same before and after. So when we're adding up the total amount of energy in these LOL diagrams, we're going to have to make it the same. So we'll give you a few examples of that. Let's say that we have a box compressing a spring that is not moving. So because this box has no velocity and it has no height, but it's compressing a spring, the only type of energy that's present right now is elastic potential energy. In a lot of these problems, these specific numbers will not be given. LOL diagrams are commonly used to qualitatively describe energy situations, which just means describing the types of energy that are present without necessarily describing the specific numbers. So I'm not going to put any numbers on the graph for this one, but I will for some others. So I'm going to say that my bar chart goes up 4 lines and it's all elastic potential energy. And I know that elastic potential energy is contained within the spring. The spring is the reason why the system has that elastic potential energy. I'm now going to imagine that this box is let go. Those little lines next to the box mean that the box is now moving with a velocity that is not zero. And I'm going to imagine that this is a smooth surface, so there's no friction. And what no friction means is that no heat energy, which we here call internal energy, was created. No heat or thermal energy was created as a result of this box moving along the floor. So because there's no more spring energy, and that caused the box to move, and the box didn't gain any height, all of that energy had to go into the box, so I'm going to include that as the other object in my system, and it all went into kinetic energy specifically. So that's what my LOL diagram would look like for this situation. The box started not moving with just elastic potential energy, and after it had only kinetic energy, and the energy went from the spring into the box. Here's example number two. We can now imagine that the box is compressing a spring still, but it's now facing a ramp. I can see that it does not have any gravitational potential to start off, so all of that energy must still be elastic energy, and it's still contained within the spring. I'm going to imagine that we let it go, and it goes a certain height up the ramp before coming to a stop. So at the end here, I'm going to say that the velocity is zero again. So what happened here is the elastic potential of the spring went into the box as kinetic energy. Whenever gravitational potential energy appears as a part of our problem, we need to include the thing that is giving our object gravitational potential energy, which here is the entire Earth. And you may be thinking back to the momentum unit where it was really bad to have the Earth in our system of objects. But here in energy, it's actually not really a big deal because we can calculate exactly how much gravitational potential the Earth is giving the object using mgh. So it's totally fine to include Earth in our system of objects in energy, but we can't do it in momentum because it's basically impossible to do momentum calculations with the Earth. But in energy, we just use m times g times h to find how much energy it's giving to an object. So because the change here is still just between mechanical energies, from the elastic potential in the spring to the kinetic in the box to the gravitational potential in the Earth, all the energy is conserved. The total must stay the same. So my final value must also be a bar that goes up 4 lines. And because this box has stopped at a certain height above the ground, it doesn't have any kinetic, so all of its energy must be gravitational potential. We're assuming here again that this is a smooth surface, so there was no thermal energy created by friction, so there's no internal energy on my chart. So all of that energy has gone into gravitational potential. That's what the LOL diagram would look like in example two. Can move through example three. We can see that again it's all elastic energy to start, so that means that the spring is in our system. We let the box go, and we're going to imagine that it keeps moving with a non-zero velocity after it gets up that hill. So that hill is not high enough to slow it to a stop. So the box is a part of our system because that's where the elastic potential energy went when it changed into kinetic energy. And the Earth is also a part of our system, because the box is now higher, it has a certain amount of height compared to where it was when it started. So that means it has a certain potential to fall back down that height. That's what gives it potential energy, just gaining more height. So I have a problem here, because I can't tell exactly how much kinetic compared to the potential it has, and I don't have any numbers to back me up. So that means that I can actually choose for myself what proportion of this object's energy became kinetic energy, and what proportion became gravitational potential. There are multiple right answers for these kinds of LOL diagrams that don't give you numbers to calculate. All that I know for sure is that the total has to stay the same, so the total has to still add to four lines. So as an example, I could split up those four lines into two for kinetic and two for potential like this. Or I could say it has three lines of kinetic and one of potential, or one of kinetic and three of potential. I don't have any way of saying that one is better or worse than the other, so there are multiple correct answers here. This is just kind of eyeballing it. In example number four, we can now imagine that this box is compressing a spring aiming straight up, so all of its energy is still elastic, and its energy is contained in the spring. And we can imagine that after it's launched, it rises to a certain height where its final velocity is zero. That means that the energy went into the box as kinetic energy, and then after, the Earth gave it gravitational potential energy. So those are the three objects in my energy system again. And at the very end of its motion, it stopped. Its final velocity is zero, so that means that all of the energy went into gravitational potential energy because it's currently at a stop. For example number five, I'm imagining that we're looking at the same box, but now we're only looking at it when it's halfway up its full potential height. So here its velocity is not zero yet, it's still moving up. So before, all of its energy is still elastic energy. Because the box is only at half of the total height that it's going to have, and I know that the potential energy is equal to m times g times h, if you cut h in half, that means the potential energy is also cut in half. So I know that at the very end, all of its energy is going to be potential energy, so it's all going to be four lines of potential energy. But here, where it's only halfway up, only half of its energy must be gravitational potential, and because it's moving, the other half must be kinetic. So that's an interesting pattern. Whenever an object is up exactly half as high as it's going to go in the vertical direction, half of its energy has been changed into gravitational potential, and the other half is still kinetic. Here's example number six. This is our first example of a rough surface, so there's some friction present. So I'm going to assume that before, this object is moving very fast, so before it encounters this rough surface, all of its energy is kinetic, and that kinetic energy exists in the box. But as the box moves across the floor takes some of its kinetic energy and changes it into thermal energy with friction. So I'm going to include the floor as one of my objects. So afterwards, some of that kinetic energy must have been changed into internal energy, which is thermal energy. And we don't know exactly how much. I'm going to imagine it's just 1 and 3, like this. But if you wanted to say it was 2 and 2 or 3 and 1, that would also be totally fine, because we're not given numbers here. Example number 7 is the first example where we are given numbers. You can see that I'm given a k constant, an initial velocity, a stretch of the spring, and a mass of the object. Using these values, I can see that all of the energy of the box to start off is going to be elastic potential energy, and using the equation 1 half kx squared, I can calculate the specific elastic potential to be 8 joules. So that means that I'm going to put 8 joules at the top of this graph, and if I put 0 at the bottom, I can easily put the other numbers in like this. So as long as they're even increments, I'm going to say this is 2, 4, 6, and 8 joules, like that. So we can now use these graphs to calculate other missing values in our problems. As an example, I can see that if the hill that this box is going up is 0.1 meters, the gravitational potential energy that it's going to have when it's on top of the hill is equal to its mass times the acceleration of gravity times h, which rounded is equal to 2 joules. So I know that after it climbs this hill, 2 joules of energy will be gravitational potential energy. And because it doesn't have any elastic potential left, the rest of the energy must exist as kinetic energy. So because I know that the total is staying the same, and it starts off with 8 joules of elastic, and there are now 2 joules of gravitational, there must be 6 joules of kinetic energy. And because I know that kinetic energy is equal to 1 half mv squared, I can actually use that to solve for the velocity. When I do, I find that the velocity is 2.4 meters per second. So that's really exciting to us, because the ultimate goal of physics is to be able to predict motion. And we just predicted the exact velocity of an object moving across a smooth surface, rising a very specific amount, after compressing a spring a very specific amount. And if you do this in the real world, these are the actual values that show up, because energy is really actually conserved, and the way that objects move through the world fits these patterns. Here's example 8. This is the first example of an open system in an LOL diagram. In an open system, the total energy before and after the event can change. So before, I'm going to imagine that this object is not moving and it's on a smooth surface. So I'm going to exclude the person from my system because the person is kind of adding energy from outside. So I don't really want to consider the energy that's already in the person because that's chemical energy from the food that they eat, which I cannot account for in these LOL diagrams. So before, the total energy of the box is just zero. It doesn't have any type of energy. And after this person pushes it, it has a certain amount of kinetic energy that it's not going to lose because there's no friction here. So this is what an open system LOL diagram looks like. The total before and after do not have to equal each other. We can now imagine that this is a very rough surface. So if this is a rough surface, the person pushing on the box is going to be met by a force of friction pushing back against the person. So anytime any kinetic energy is given to the box, it's immediately converted by the floor into heat energy. So after this person pushes this box for a certain amount, all of its energy is going to be heat energy and it's not going to move. This fits another real-world experience. If we start to push an object across a very smooth, slippery surface and let go, the object will continue to move because none of its energy has been converted to heat. But if we push it across a rough surface, it's not going to have any kinetic energy, and so it's not going to move. All of its energy was changed into internal or thermal energy. One last topic to cover in LOL diagrams is elastic and inelastic collisions. In an elastic collision, kinetic energy is conserved. That's actually the definition of an elastic collision. And in an inelastic collision, some energy is lost to heat. So we can imagine that these carts are moving towards each other, so if we add up their total energies, it's going to add up to be some total kinetic energy. And after they impact each other, if they have a perfect elastic collision, that's going to be the same amount of kinetic energy after the collision. However, if we imagine that they have an inelastic collision instead, in example 11, if their energy all starts off as kinetic energy, some of their energy is going to be converted into internal energy. The way to find specifically how much energy was converted is to use the fact that the momentum is also conserved, so you can find the total velocities of the two objects after the collision, and then use that to calculate their kinetic energy. And however much less that kinetic energy is than what they started with, that difference between the initial and final kinetic is going to equal the internal energy. If the two objects come to a perfect stop after the collision, that means that all of their kinetic energy was transformed into internal energy. And that's how you draw LOL diagrams. Obviously, these are very versatile and can describe a lot of very different situations, and you're going to get a lot of practice with them over the next few days.